Hi, so this is my first talk in Thailand, and I really love the weather here. A bit harsh, but I liked it because it's different. So coming to me, I'm Santosh. I work as a senior development engineer in Pramati in India. And to make a sense of my existence, I volunteer to Mozilla as an open source contributor. I have been volunteering to Mozilla from the past 6 years. I worked on different projects. I contributed to different products. And previously, before Pramati, I used to work with Infosys and Gaian in India. So today, I'm going to talk about writing JavaScript with better performance. How many of you code JavaScript? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Yeah, cool. So since more than half of the people don't code in JavaScript, so I'll take the session in a way that it's better coding practices for everyone. But I'll talk about specifically for JavaScript. Sounds cool? Yeah. So this is what I'm going to talk about. I'm going to talk a little about JavaScript and. I'm going to talk about few case studies which actually helped me to propose this talk to this conference. And I'm going to talk about few tips and introduce you to few tools which you can use to improve your code performance. So JavaScript is one of the oldest scripting languages out there. It's 2.5 decades old, and it was actually started as a scripting language for web pages. But later on, if you see JavaScript right now, it's everywhere. It was on web pages before, now it's on the servers running on Node.js. And it is on VR devices. And even if you have, how many of you have heard about HoloLens from Microsoft, VR devices? So Microsoft created a framework to develop applications for HoloLens, which is called as HoloJS, a couple of years back. And even robots have JavaScript. So currently, JavaScript, which was introduced as only for web pages, it is spreading towards everywhere. So it's always completely evolving, which makes the developer life easier and better. What happened? Oh. Yeah, easy to write and debug. So what do you code? Do you build any mobile apps or anything? So I'll tell you my story. When I first started coding, I was developing applications for Windows. So for that, I had only 2 GB RAM of machine. But to develop mobile applications for Windows, you need to have at least 4 GB of RAM at that time. So I had to install Visual Studio. I have to install few SDKs. And then I will actually go and create my application, which is tiresome. If you are a beginner who is just getting started with, you're going to get frustrated because of the time it takes and the resources it takes. And the first time when I started to build my first web page, so I just opened my notepad and created a file called as index.html and wrote hello world on it and opened it with browser. It was as simple as that. I didn't need anything to write and debug my web pages. So that is why people are more interested. If someone wants to learn a coding language, they start with JavaScript because it's easier to actually set up and write your first page. And I have been working in a proper job from the past 4 years. So my first project was a 10 to 15 year old JavaScript based project. It was using some framework, but let's talk only in JavaScript sense. So I was working on that. So if I want to do any action or if you want to write any functionality, I used to see how my seniors wrote and I used to just copy paste it and then make the changes. So I think most of you people do the same thing, right? So then again, I joined in a startup and I built many products from scratch. So where I actually learned how to write from scratch. And again, in my next job, I got into a 5-year-old project where I have to write new things and also correct existing things. So when I was going through the code base, now it's like, okay, my first project, I was just a beginner. I don't know if I point out a mistake, they might repoint it to me that it is going to be my mistake. So I didn't do that. But now I'm a senior, so I can point out things. So that is when I got to learn about like how other developers are writing code, and I started to figure out if there are any better ways to do it. So one of the first things which I saw in all of the code base was, so we have multiple tables where we get an array of 100 objects. So in JavaScript, objects are mutable. So if you copy the object to other variable, and if you change in any of the one variable, it gets replicated in both. So the easiest way every developer was doing it in my code was, they are first converting my object into string, and then again they are converting my string into object. So JSON is like, it's already a method available in JavaScript, so they were using it to do this. So I started to think like it. So if something comes so easily in JavaScript, then there should be a catch for it, right? So if there is something which you are easily doing it in any programming language, there is a catch. So I found the catch here. So I started to write, compare different ways to copy a JavaScript. So the last one was what we generally using it, and there were other types. So map is like, think of it like a for loop if you are not a JavaScript developer. So I was like using an array, I was using a for loop for an array and then copying the things. But then if I just compare the performance, so the regular method which I'm using is like 60% slower on the last column if you see it. So we had like 100 pages in the in our whole web app, and 100 times we are reducing the performance of our code by 60% using a non-feasible method. So here I found a better approach when comparing different performance. So for this, there are many tools out there. If you are writing a simple code snippet and if you want to compare the performances, there are multiple websites already available there, and I was using jsperf.com for this. And then this was one thing. So if there is a catch if it comes easy for us, but there should always be something better. There should be an advantage for that method. So in JavaScript, the objects work in a different way. Here, if I want to, if I have an object inside another object, if I convert into string and then JSON, I convert into an object, it completely converts it, it completely changes the references. But if I use the previous method, only the first level of objects are being converted. So I was doing I was deep cloning it, I was completely cloning one object into another object using Lodash. And I found that the before method which we were using is faster. So here is one thing I understood. So if you have only one level of objects, then use the map which I was showing in the before slide. But if you have multiple level of objects, object inside an object inside an object, so then at that time, you better use the methods provided by JavaScript to improve performance. And so this is one thing. There are multiple ways to do a simple thing in any coding language. But the most better one with best performance is which has the less steps. So I'm both are doing the same thing. It's going to display a text called as text summit after slicing it. So the first one, it's a straightforward method, and it was fastest, very fast. And I included just two extra steps in the second method. Even though the output is same in both things, the second one is 100% slower. Just a simple step might cost you a lot. But think of it as this way. Now we have 8 GB of RAMs and 100 Mbps of internet easily. So we might not have found it. But what if your application is being used in a remote area where people are using 2G network? So you should write your code for everyone. Even just with the simple change, you're going to improve it a lot. And this was one thing. Like in JavaScript, there are like multiple for loops. And so this one here, I was just logging every item in my array using different methods. And I got the statistics here. So if you see, the first one, array.map, is the slowest one, which is 6% slower than the rest of the things. But I did something else with the same array loop. So here, I am copying one element to one array to another array. So the one which was slowest in the before one is the fastest now. So let me tell you, I'll tell you the story behind this. So if you write a for loop or for each, so every method or anything will have a return type. Even map has a return type which returns an array. And the other for loops are just like it will return an undefined value. So if you are writing a loop which is returning an array, then use map. If you are writing a loop which doesn't need to return anything, then use for each or for. So this is one of the important analysis which I found. And this is one thing which we generally do in JavaScript. So our if loops in any programming language actually takes the Boolean value as an input parameter, right? So it should be either a true value or false. But in JavaScript, it can take a number. It can take a string. It will do an internal typecasting. So it will typecast into a Boolean value and then run the code. So here, I stored a variable called as str. I gave it as an empty string. And if I do like compare str equal to empty string, then it goes inside the loop, right? So this is one way. Or I can actually use which is common in all programming language, and str. So both does the same thing. Both are success scenarios. But the second one is faster, because here you are not doing any typecasting. If you do str equal to empty string, it will actually return you a true. So which is like there is no typecasting needed for the if loop. But the first one, it converts the empty string into a Boolean value. It typecasts it, which will return false. And that false, using the not, you are converting it into true and then using it. So the other method is like very simple. It's only the same line of code, but the performance is improved in here. Just I'm comparing it with the basic code. But think of about some robust code and how it's going to affect it. So yeah, so these are few case scenarios I compared when I started working on that 5-year-old project. And when it comes to tips, minimize your scope chain. This is the first thing which I learned. In JavaScript, if you declare any variable, not inside a function, but if you declare anywhere else, it will be assigned to the global object. If you so now here I wrote like constant number one, number two, I declared it. But if in my whole of code base, if I write like window.number1, window.number2, then it actually gives me that number. Because these are assigned to the global chain. And if I'm writing an add function and returning like adding two numbers, then it is going to add those two numbers and it will pick from the global chain. So it's like process. So first it will check for this method. If there is a number one, then it's okay. No, there is no number one. So go to the parent method. So is there a number one there? Yes, so then use it. If no, then go to the parent method and check for number one. If it is not there, then okay, this is fine. This is the top level. It will read it as undefined. So instead of that, so declare it inside your methods and reduce the scope chain of that. So if I write it, so I recently listened to a talk by other person on functional programming. So this is one of the concept of functional programming. Each function is independent. If I put this function, I remove this function from this slide and use it in another slide, so it will work because it is not dependent on any other external factors. So here I'm using the local variable, number one and number two. Num one and num two are local variables. I'm actually reduce the scope chain and using that. And there are multiple conditions in every programming language. We have if else, if, we have switch. So there are multiple loops. And when it comes to tips, like what should you use? If you are having any Boolean comparisons, okay. So if my name is Santosh, then do this. If my name is not Santosh, then do that. So if it's only like true or false scenarios, then use if loop, if else loop. And if you have like different things, okay, if I'm in India, so use INR. If I'm in Thailand, use baht. If I'm in Singapore, use Singapore dollars. So if I have multiple conditions which I have to compare, then I should use, I'll use switch. If you have a look at pictorial flowchart, then you will have a better idea on this. So this is the same thing which I was talking about. If loops actually take booleans, so give them booleans, not any other thing, so that your JavaScript code internally typecast it to the boolean value. And keep your DOM interactions to the minimum. So we have this habit of taking the reference of the HTML element in your JavaScript and then write function events and functions on it, right? So now here, like there is an input element which has an ID username. I wrote like key up, key down, and focus event. So when it is focused, so maybe highlight the border. When I'm going to write that. So when I'm going to like key up or key down, just check if it is a number or string. So all these things, so I'm interacting the DOM, I'm getting the element and doing the events. So instead of that, like get the element once, so you have your JavaScript reference and use that everywhere in your application. So you have interacted with the DOM only once, so you are like, and you are working on your own local object. So it will be like, really, it will improve your performance to a great extent. And avoid using jQuery. I'm not sure if I'm going to tell you this or not, but when I started learning JavaScript, so the first things I used to do is import Bootstrap, import jQuery. So Bootstrap to actually design my page in an easier way, and jQuery to write selectors in a simple way. So if you write a jQuery, like get an element like dollar of, get an element with class name focus. So it will like traverse to every DOM node. It will go to your body, then again main, then again division, then H1, P1. It will traverse through every DOM node and then gets you the elements which you need. So so that is why, I mean, if you're not going to use it, like not properly going to use it, then avoid using jQuery. So yeah, this is one thing which I started using, bundle analyzers. So if it is a smaller application which you're going to run it once, then you are good. So if you want to like build it faster, so it's fine. But if the size of your application is increasing, then you better use this bundle analyzer. So what they do is they analyze all the bundles, all the libraries which you are using in your application, and then give a size comparison of which library is using how much memory in your code. For example, if I'm using Lodash or underscore, which many people use, but I am using it only to get the minimum value of an array. So for that simple functionality, it is better not to import a complete library, right? I'll write the same code in my own code, then it's done, instead of like giving a chunk of my memory to that underscore library. And TypeScript, so this is one of the beautiful thing which I've been coding from the past, from the past 2 years, I guess, and I really loved it. So when it comes to Java or any other programming language, you give a type to every variable. If it is string, you declare it as a string. If it's a number, you declare it as a number. But in JavaScript, it's always, you will use the same keyword, where, let, or constant, to declare a variable. So, but so this is my JavaScript code. This is how I write a program to add two numbers. And if I like give 4 and 5, then it's fine. It will take it. If I give an empty string also instead of a number, it will just display me a string 4. The first one will display me a 9, and next one will be 4. Because in JavaScript, it takes like both a string and a number. You can add both things. So that is why this one happens. But if I write a TypeScript file, so then I'm going to declare the type of each of my variable. So in this one, I declared the number 1 has number and number 2 has number. Then I added those numbers. So if I write like add of 4 comma 5, then it adds to those two numbers, because the numbers, the function add only takes numbers and I'm giving it numbers. But in the second line, I'm using add of an empty string or some string, comma 4. But we wrote like it should accept only numbers. So it will give me an array. Sorry, I think it's not visible from you there. So it says that argument of type empty string is not assignable to parameter of type number. So it throws you out an error immediately when you're writing your code itself. So this is this will be really helpful in other scenarios as well. So one of the other scenario is like if you're writing a function saying is valid, which will return you a Boolean type. So that code will actually compile and it will work only when it returns a Boolean. So for example, if I wrote like is valid, I declared the return type as Boolean. If I write like return yes, so yes is a string. That function doesn't work. It doesn't compile. So this is how TypeScript helps you to write better code with few failing and error scenarios. And even the IDEs are great. So I use Visual Code for writing my TypeScript. So if I declared like conference name and like I declared it as OpenText Summit, if I write conference dot, so it will give me what are the variables present in that object, which is general, but it gives the type of that variable as well. So here it says property name is string. So the IntelliSense in the IDEs really help you if you're using TypeScript. And this is what TypeScript website says about TypeScript. So it's a superset of JavaScript which compiles into plain JavaScript that can run on any browser, any host, or any OS. And it's open source. If I write something like this, so if you are a JavaScript developer, you might be using the latest JavaScript feature. You might be using arrow functions. You might be using the keywords of let and constant, which are there in recent JavaScript. But if you try to run them on some old Internet Explorer, your code will break because your code is still in ES6, which is not supported by older browsers. But when you write the TypeScript code, it compiles to the language which it compiles to the version which most of the browsers support, which is ES 2015. So if you just observe this code, so I'm using a map function. Like I'm using the arrow function in the second line, and the first line I'm using constant keyword. So if I compile it, it like converts the code automatically into where keyword and the function, which is an older version of writing callbacks. So what should we do? Like if we are like writing JavaScript, what should we actually do? So let an extra pair of eyes look at your code. Even if you are an experienced developer, even if you are like a beginner, it's always good to have an extra pair of eyes look at your code. So there is nothing wrong in that because like even I'm a 5 years experienced guy, but still I ask a junior developer to sometimes look at my code. So there is two things that's gonna happen. Either he will learn from my code or he will teach me something about my code. So it's always good to let your code look at by another developer. And prevention is better than cure. I think our ancestors have actually came up with this code for health reasons, but it actually applies even today. So if you're writing any code with large code bases, you better introduce some coding guidelines so that multiple developers, when you work on it, you won't clash each other's code and each other's rule sets. So this is one thing. And import only when you actually need it. If you are importing 10 modules in a particular component, and if you are going to use only like 6 or 7 modules, so better import only those 6 or 7 modules and import the other modules when you later use it. So it reduces your bundle time and it avoids all the unnecessary unnecessary modules in your code base. And write unit test cases, but I never thought this is really helpful because in my beginning, I never wrote unit test cases, but when I started writing unit test cases, I caught few error scenarios, corner cases, which helped me to write a better code. Like for example, if I'm writing a button click, so I'm going to consider only positive scenarios when I write my code for the first time, right? So if I'm writing a button click, okay, I am clicking on it, and okay, I got a pop-up, then I'll type something, then clicks on okay. So this is the success scenarios which I'm going to do. But when I write unit test cases, I'll consider like when my code considers the other things as well. So what if instead of clicking the button, he will just hover over it? Or if he hold the button for like maybe like some longer time, or if he clicks on anywhere around the button. So my unit test cases, I was just taking it as an example, but unit test cases help you to like find those error scenarios and other scenarios which will help you to write a better code.
Source detect. No signal, yeah.
So those are some of the tips. Even there are other tips also. So once it is up, I'm going to tell you. So these are a few things. Share your code with other people. If you are doing something and if you are using a library for it, then you better use. So for example, it's like. If you are using a sorting functionality, if you are writing a code, instead of that, better use some other library because they should already be tested with better performance. So if you use that code which is written by other developers, it will be like really helpful. And reusability is one of the important thing. If you are writing a code, write it in a way that if you like pluck it out of that code base and if you paste it in other code base, it should work as expected. No, it's gone. So this is one more thing. I think I'm done. If my presentation gets up, I might come up with two more tips. But yeah, any questions?
Thank you for your information. This is very valuable indeed. But is this a lot to take in for a semi-beginner like me? And I just thought that all that you have spoken and had given to all of us, can we arrange it into a book or something?
Yeah, so sure. So yeah. I started whenever I learn something, I have a habit of blogging it. Writing a post and publishing on Medium or dev.to. So you can go through those articles. So if you are that's a good question. If you are a beginner or semi-beginner, you first just make sure that it's happening. So if you are writing something, okay, it's working. So that is what you will check. And go ahead with that, do that. So once your code works, then start thinking, is there any way I can make this code perform better? If there is any better way to write that code. So do what you're doing right now, and after writing that, just think about a better approach for that. So there are multiple books, multiple blog posts already available, but these are my personal learning, so which might not be available, but which will soon be available when I post it. Yeah, thank you.
Have you ever considered writing a book?
I considered, I started, but I never finished it. Yeah.
Yes.
Any other questions? No questions? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mr. Viswanatham, the next program, we will now have a 30 minutes break. Please be back at 11 o'clock.
So I will make my slides, I'll tweet my slides, so you can just go through the link and look at the other tips as well, which I introduced, and the other tools which you can use. Okay? So you can follow me at isantoshv on Twitter. Isantoshv, yeah.